Hi everybody and welcome to today's construction clinic. This is the third in the series and today we're delighted to welcome back Paul Gibbons and Mark Watson, both fellows and members of the steering committee, and as you know Paul is also the ICCP president. So great to have you all with us. Before we get started, as usual, we'll just go through a couple of housekeeping points. Pretty straightforward. The only things you need to really be aware of, on your screen you should have a hand icon. If you have any issues with audio today, please just raise your hand. I'll drop you a message, see if we can sort you out. Today is all about your questions, so if you have any questions for our presenters today, you have a question box here, so feel free to send your questions in through the box. Otherwise, if you'd like to ask your question live on the session, again, just raise your hand. I'll unmute your microphone. If you do opt for that, though, please make sure you've got your audio and microphone set up properly. Otherwise, it does interfere a little bit. Okay, so for those of you who haven't heard of us before, just a very quick introduction to the ICCP. So what is the ICCP? Well, we are a professional members organisation and we recognise those with skills, qualifications and expertise in the professional management of construction claims. We've got three key objectives and those are to establish international professional standards for the management of claims, to give recognition to those who have gained the appropriate knowledge and skills in the management of claims, and also to help and educate those who would like to gain that experience and forge their career in that direction. So membership, we offer three levels of membership, associate, member and fellow. Each level comes with a set of prerequisites which must be met to join at the desired level. I'm not going to go into all of those details today, but enough to say if you would like some more information and to read what those requirements are, you'll find all of the details on the ICCP website. And also today, we'd just like to give a nod to Claims Class. The clinics are actually run in partnership with Claims Class, who is the ICCP's accredited training partner. There are routes to membership through Claims courses, either at associate or member level, depending on the course that you take. So the courses on offer are listed on the screen there, and there's various ways to learn. Most popular at the moment are the e-courses, given the working situation and everybody being at home. There's different levels, basic, intermediate and premium. They all come with different benefits and features. So again, if you are interested in gaining the skills needed to be an effective claims practitioner or to gain entry into the Institute, then do have a look at Claims Class and their courses. They are also offering a 20% saving on all courses at the moment to try and help those who may have been impacted by the effects of coronavirus. Okay, so if you'd like to learn more, as I said, visit the ICCP website. Feel free to drop me a line. My email address is there on the screen for you. We're happy to have a chat and help you out with more information. Okay, so the clinic is now open and I believe Paul is going to kick things off for us today. So over to you, Paul.
Let's get the camera to work. Good afternoon, everybody. Good to see you all, and thank you for joining us on this webinar. Today, I've been asked to provide some responses around some questions that have been received, particularly around NEC, COVID-19, and some prolongation elements. So the first question that I will jump to is from Jonathan Watson. And Jonathan asks, what is the remedy under the NEC3 engineering construction contract for where there is a defect notified by the employer, but this is a latent defect and notified after the defects date? And the question is the contractor obliged to correct this? Well, the NEC3 sets out the obligations of what the supervisor and the project manager and indeed the contractor should do. And those obligations to notify about defects are set out in clause 42. the contractor's obligations in terms of dealing with the defect and resolving the defect is set out in clause 43. And clause 44 permits either the contractor or the PM that they can propose that the defect is notified, but nothing is carried out with that defect and it remains uncorrected or unremedied, as it were. But in the effect of latent defects, notified of the defects date, in essence, it is the contractor's responsibility that until the end of the relevant limitation period under English law, which is either 6 years if the defect arises through negligence, and either 6 or 12 years if it's a breach of contract. So in essence, if a defect under the NEC is notified after the defect date and it's a latent defect, then the contractor is obliged to correct this within in accordance with the limitation period set out under English law. So as I say, that's either 6 or 12 years, depending on the deed or contract. But the NEC, as I say, it sets out different procedures, far too many iterations to go through in detail. But in essence, the main clauses you need to look at are clause 42, 43, 44, with the backstop being the limitation period set out under English law. Okay, so that deals with the latent defects for Jonathan. So hopefully that's resolved that one for you, Jonathan. Moving on then to another question from Vanessa Callego. Hopefully I've pronounced that properly. Vanessa asked the question, what if you actually submitted a notice but quoted a wrong clause from the contract? I'm presuming here, Vanessa, you're referring to a contractual notice with regards to delay, disruption, or indeed additional costs. It obviously, depending on what your view is, I would always suggest that you want to ensure that you fully understand the basis of your contract before you go citing incorrect clauses, because it may well become fatal if you don't reference the specific contract clause. And your contract will tell you whether that is right or wrong in terms of referencing the correct clause. But under NEC, let's say, for example, if I was to be quoting a specific project manager's instruction as a notification, but I actually quoted an incorrect subclause of clause 60, then that might cause me some frustration and some issues further on in my dialogue with the project manager. Similarly, with regards to JCT, if I'm quoting the incorrect relevant event for a delay or a relevant matter for loss and expense, that would also potentially cause me issues with regards to dealing with a contract administrator. So I would be suggesting that you do need to understand your contract, understand clearly what notice you are going to be issuing and what it is for. If in doubt, I wouldn't necessarily put down a specific clause. I would just say, in accordance with clause 60, I'm notifying you of my notice, and then perhaps take a bit of time, be mindful of the long stop dates in the various contracts for getting notifications in on time and the further detailed particulars. But I'll be suggesting that if you don't know a specific clause, buy yourself a bit of time, notify under clause 60 or clause 2 or clause 4 if it's JCT for loss and expense. Then have a discussion internally, perhaps to your legal representatives, perhaps to your commercial team. Get a collective view as to what that notification clause should be, and then submit, clarify your notice cleanly after the event. But as I say, the ideal situation is to know your contract from the get-go. Okay, so that hopefully, Vanessa, deals with your notice submission question. Moving on then, I've got a question here from Simon Hedger. And Simon asks, as a result of COVID-19, he's heard in the UK that main contractors are engaging directly with lawyers rather than claims consultants to assist with contract analysis given that the main contractors seem likely have entitlement to time only and no money. Is this what you've been seeing, and any comments? In my discussions with our legal friends, we are aware that a lot of the lawyers have been assisting main contractors to ensure that notifications are given correctly in accordance with the contracts that they are engaged under. And those notifications obviously put markers down in terms of making sure that either time is reimbursed and or money is reimbursed where the contractor has entitlement. But where we as an organisation, as consultants have seen an upturn, is we're being asked to give advice on, well, what records need to be maintained to demonstrate our entitlement when we come through at the end of this COVID-19 period. So, for example, I was on a call with a contractor on Thursday last week, a big international contractor, and they were asking me what records should we be maintaining in this period of delay and frustration and disruption. And basically it goes back to having good contemporaneous records in terms of labour, resources, where production has not been able to be progressed, photographic evidence, good monthly reports going in. Now, again, here in the UK, we've got a lot of the main contractors have furloughed. That means they've temporarily put their team on stop. So their teams are all at home, not able to carry out works on site. So therefore, any progress reports, progress reporting, progress records might not be able to be maintained, but there needs to be a select few individuals that are maintained on these construction projects, in my opinion, that are maintained to collate these detailed records, because they're going to need to be accurate to ensure that entitlement has been developed. So yes, the lawyers have been helping with putting notifications in correctly, but we are seeing a real request to give advice as to, well, what does a good record look like? Please, can you assist? So Simon, hopefully that answers your question around what you've been hearing in the UK. And again, I'll be interested to hear what others' views are in terms of other jurisdictions. Mark, maybe you might want to pass some comment on what you're finding in Africa in terms of what's going on there. But we'll come on to that one shortly. And the final question that I've got currently is from Kuldip Singh. And Kuldip asked the question, is it possible to claim prolongation claims due to COVID-19? And moreover, in this particular answer that Kuldip has asked, there are materials which need to be delivered from other countries in order to complete the project on time. So if I could refer Kuldip back to our clinic number one, which was a couple of weeks ago, which Andy Hewitt and myself did, we dealt with at length around how you can and cannot claim for prolongation costs with regards to COVID-19. Just to quickly run through that for you, Kuldip, in essence, under FIDIC, you get an extension of time under 8.4 and you get costs under 19.4. So you are entitled to prolongation claims. Under JCT, you can and you can't get costs for prolongation. And what I mean by that is it all depends whether a relevant event under clause 2 is also a relevant matter under clause 4. And it's clause 4 of the JCT that gives the contractor entitlement to loss and expense. So you've got to make sure that a relevant event is also a relevant matter. I go into further detail on this in our initial clinic number one. And under NEC, yes, you do get prolongation costs wrapped up in a compensation event under clause 60. But as I've alluded to in the clinic number one, the COVID-19 scenario, when is it going to last and when is it going to finish, is unknown. So the NEC asks, and it states that you should be forecasting the effects of the NEC, sorry, the forecasting the effects of COVID-19. Well, how can you forecast realistically when COVID-19 might finish and when the effects it might finish? So it'll be really, it's risky if the contractor makes those assumptions. What the contractor should be doing is putting the emphasis back on the PM and asking the PM to state assumptions as to how the COVID-19 situation should be priced. The contractor prices those assumptions. If those assumptions prove to be incorrect, then the contractor can then go back and put another compensation event quote in, or ask the PM to change their previous assumptions and then revalue that accordingly. So again, Cordic, it all depends which contract you're dealing with. We've just dealt with specific standard forms there. You may well have bespoke matters, bespoke contracts, other types of contracts, you know, MF1, the IKME, for example, and they all deal with matters differently. So that deals with my questions that have been brought to my attention. So I know we're galloping through this, but I'm also conscious of the time, and I think Mark's got some other detailed questions for you to get answered. So I'll hand over to you, Mark. Thank you.
Thanks, Paul. Good afternoon, everybody. First question I'll be responding to is the question received by Geert de Wilde. Geert asks, if an employee's delay, excusable and compensable, is ongoing and determines the date of completion, and after the effects of COVID-19, there is an additional delay to the date of completion, will the overlapping delay be compensated? This is a typical question revolving around concurrency, which is a hot topic in construction. Now, in order to determine or establish if you will be paid for that overlapping period, you need to look at the terms of the actual contract. And Paul has just touched on the various terms of the contract, but you've got to consider at under 19.4, clause 19.4, is a part A and a part B, which says you're entitled to part A, the extension of time, and part B would be the additional payment. However, that part B is subject to certain requirements under the second part of the clause, subclause 19.1. Now, the second part of subclause 19.1 lists all those events that is deemed to be a force majeure event. But at the same time, the clause also states that it's not limited to. Now, if that event is listed there, that means it was foreseeable. If it was not, if it is not listed there, that means it was not foreseeable. And in the event that to be paid for prolongation under the legal term, is that when an event is foreseeable, it does not remove the first event. So if your employee's delay was the first event, and your second event, which is your COVID-19, was foreseeable, it will not remove the entitlement under the first event or that overlapping period. However, if that COVID-19 event was an unforeseeable event, was not foreseen, then that COVID-19 event becomes a new event. And in terms of your contract, if it's not foreseeable or foreseeable, you will then be entitled to payment in terms of that. I trust I've answered that question to your satisfaction. The second question received from Simon Rowlands. He asked, are notices submitted under subclause 13.7 and subclause 19.2 of FIDIC 1999 Red Book mutually exclusive? Or can the contractor claim under both subclauses for the same event? If you look under the requirements of subclause 13.7 and 19.2, there are specific requirements that are different. Under subclause 13.2, it states that it must affect the performance, and that those events must be attributable to a change in law. either a new law implemented, an existing law taken away, or an amendment to an existing law. Whereas 19.2 talks about the prevention of performance, and it must be an event that is characterized as a force majeure event. Now, under FERIC, why I'm using the word characterize, refer back to clause 19.1. The first part of clause 19.1 talks about the characteristics of a force majeure event. And it's the second part of clause 19.1 talks lists certain events that are deemed to be force majeure events. So your event might not be listed under the second part of 19.1, but if it meets the characteristics, that means it will still be considered as a force majeure event. So therefore, 13.7 and 19.2 are mutually exclusive, and you cannot use it for the same event, because it would be highly unlikely to find an event that is a change in law that prevents performance, that affects performance, and is a force majeure event. It is highly likely that all four of those will be at play at the same time. So 13.7 and 9.2 are mutually exclusive. The final question I will respond to is from Mahiru, H-I-R-U. I trust I've pronounced correctly. Mahiru's got five questions, so I'll attempt to go through all five. I've still got sufficient time. In the response, his first question, in the response to an EFT claim, the FERIC engineer states that one of the delay events was claimed as a force majeure. However, this event is not included in subclause 19.1. Therefore, it cannot be used as a basis for an EOT claim. Is this statement contractually tenable? As I stated earlier, clause 19.1 has got two components to it. First component talks about characteristic, and the second component lists the force majeure events. Now, if it's not listed as a force majeure event, but it's got the characteristic of a force majeure event, then you can claim the force majeure event. Therefore, that first statement would not be contractually tenable. It doesn't have to be listed there, but it's got to have the characteristics. The second question is, does an extension of time to the contract automatically entitle the contractor to prolongation costs as well? I'm going to use the same example of COVID-19. I'm going to go to subclause 19.4. Subclause 19.4 has got a part A and a part B. Part A states that if the force majeure event is listed, or if the thing is not listed, it has the characteristics of a force majeure event, you can claim the extension of time there too. Part B of 19.4 talks about you can claim costs. However, it's got to be a listed event. So that means that on the second part of 19.1, your COVID-19 must be listed there. Either COVID-19 or lockdown or pandemic must be listed as a force majeure event. If it's not listed under that 1 to 4 items, then you cannot claim the cost in terms of that. The third question is, in the absence of an approved baseline program, how could the contractor establish his EOT claim? Under FERIC, you do not have an approved baseline program. We have an 8.3 program, and the 8.3 program, only obligation it places onto the engineer is that he must notify you to the extent that your program, your 8.3 program, does not comply to the conditions of the contract, if it's a baseline program. In the second instance, if your updates to your 8.3 program do not comply to the realities of the site, or if you specify a certain method you're going to attempt something, and you've changed your method, the engineer can notify you within the prescribed period that you need to please make sure your program complies with the contract or with the conditions on the actual site. If the engineer does not provide you with a response within the prescribed period after you submit your program, you can continue with working towards that actual program. So there's no obligation or requirement were an approved baseline program in terms of the FIDIC conditions of contract. Now, your second part of your question regarding to your EOT claim, I will get to that at the end. I will answer your fourth question first. It says, the consultant says that we cannot accept your delay analysis because it is based on a program that was not approved by the FIDIC engineer. Again, the FIDIC engineer does not approve any program. So what would happen there is then that if you could have submitted programs, and I trust you have been submitting programs, the engineer has got the right to say it doesn't comply as I stated. Now, the disadvantage that you have if your programs do not comply with the contract or doesn't reflect the realities on site is that when the engineer makes determination, he can discard your actual program. And that is provided under the fourth paragraph of clause 20, sub clause 20.1. Which says that the contractor must maintain all required documents in order to substantiate his claim. The program is one such document you can use to substantiate his claim, but not on its own. You've got to have other documents feeding into your program. So if the engineer decides that he wants to discard your program, it could be detrimental to the contract in that he could be awarded an EOT, which is less than what he's entitled to, or the engineer could just say, I'm giving you no time. So the importance of is that your program plays a crucial role in substantiating your actual claim. But without the program, the engineer can still make his determination. Because when he does his determination under subclause 3.5, he has opportunity to speak to both parties individually. And you can get clarification in terms of the program at that point in time. So, and the only reason that a engineer can exclude your claim as is done over here is under the last part of last paragraph of subclause 20.1. And it states that a claim can only be excluded if the contractor failed to submit his claim within the prescribed period. That means the contract has been time bought in the claim. That's the only time that the engineer can exclude your claim. So what is done here is not best practice. I would suggest that you sit down with the engineer and try to resolve the matter because it can become a costly exercise. Now, in the event where you have a program that is unreliable, for lack of a better word, you can use a delay analysis method called as planned versus as built in Windows method. This method does not rely upon an approved baseline program or any program of that, because that method is a static method. You utilize all your continuous documentation, such as photographs, daily diaries, minutes of meeting, and you try and establish the contemporaneous critical path from a common sense basis. Because one of the biggest faults or flaws today in a critical path program is that it could be incorrectly linked, or it could be reflecting what the contract wants to reflect, so the true reflection actually happened, and use that as the basis of your delay assessment, you could get the answer as not practicable. So a lot of the times you see in industry they move towards as planned versus as built in Windows because it doesn't rely upon an actual program. And the final question is, who is the owner of the float when the contract has delayed and when the contract has accelerated? I'm assuming you say when the contractor was delayed. So in the circumstance where the contract has been delayed and is the acceleration, normally there will not be any terminal float in that situation, because you've got to accelerate, you've got to pull the date earlier. And one of the easiest ways to pull that early is reduce your terminal float. Now, both parties under the contract have an obligation to mitigate the risk, even though they're not the cause of the risk. So therefore, in this sense, the float will belong to the project. Whoever gets to it first will use it. That's all the questions I had answered. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Mark. Thank you, Paul. And that has taken us exactly to 4:30. We're going to have to call the clinic to a close there for today. Thank you to everybody who joined us. I just wanted to mention for any members on the session today, the ICCP has actually just published a very detailed paper all on coronavirus under the FIDIC contracts. So if you remember, log into your members area, that's there for you to download. If you would like any information about the ICCP, if you're not a member, get in touch with me. We'll be back next week at the same time. And we have two new presenters again for you to take your questions. If we didn't get to your question today, it'll be added to the rolling list and it'll be first up to be answered next week. So make sure you join us and hopefully we'll see you again next week. Thank you, Mark. Thank you, Paul. And we'll see you next Tuesday.
Thank you, Mark. Thank you, Nina. Thanks, everybody. Bye-bye now.
Thank you. Bye.